will represent the idea of imagery, and they are, right here in front of me, Vijay Iyer, Prashant Bhargava, and Basil Twist. I'd like to start with Basil. Basil, you and I started speaking about this almost 3 years ago, maybe 2 years ago, something like that.
Yeah.
And I tell the story already as it is, but my wife Lisa and I were in Paris for work, I promise. And one of the things that we arranged was a meeting with Basil so that he and I could talk a bit about this commission that we were offering him with the Rite of Spring. And we hadn't actually met at that point. So we were sitting next to the Comédie Française on a little cafe. It was very idyllic. And all of a sudden comes this guy rollerblading through the streets of Paris right towards us and ends up being Basil Twist. And he tells us the story of in getting his inspiration for this work. He was actually had his iPod in his headphones rollerblading through Paris with the Rite of Spring playing. Can you tell a little bit about that and how that might get to start?
Yeah, well, I'm a puppeteer is what I do, and but I've worked with music a lot, and at first I kind of thought I would naturally use I wanted to do the Rite of Spring, so actually take the piece and interpret it in some way, and so I thought I would use the piano reduction and do it on, you know, maybe on this cool little stage, which I love this theater, and as I was in Paris and rollerblading, and I would go by the Théâtre Champs-Élysées, and I was listening to different recordings, and it just became completely clear that for me to kind of honor the Rite of Spring, what I needed to do, I needed to do it big. I needed to do it with a full orchestra, and I needed to kind of challenge myself with some things that I had wanted to do, dreamed of doing, and I had to do it. That was the way to honor the Rite of Spring. That the Rite of Spring, as magnificent as the music is, it's still, you know, it's been appropriated into movie soundtracks, and you know, it's like it's magnificent, but it doesn't shock us the same way as it must have shocked that audience. And it, but how to honor its legacy, and the way to honor it is for an artist to really push themselves. So. Fortunately, Emil agreed to that and said, okay, sure, and set me up with the St. Luke's Orchestra and has provided Memorial Hall for me to explore and take some work that I had done in kind of abstraction in puppetry and to move it into a much bigger scale. And that's really, for me, what it is about this piece. It's like breaking the mold, trying to do something new and trying to do something a little bit frightening.
Well, I think the question I get when we talk about you is, he's a puppeteer. Are we going to see just a lot of puppets? I'm kidding, of course.
Uh-huh.
But I think maybe if you can just speak a little further more on this abstraction idea. And perhaps I think we have a video that you want to show as well, right?
Oh, so. Yeah. If we have the video, it'll say a lot. But although I do more traditional puppetry where you have kind of a representative, frequently miniature version of a human being, I've done a lot of work in more abstract puppetry where the essence, kind of like actually I loved that Colin was talking about Kandinsky, because Kandinsky was a big influence to me in considering abstraction and abstraction in relationship to music. And the essence of a thing. So the essence of puppetry is just when something comes to life. So something that's inanimate suddenly becomes animate, and a puppeteer does that. And you know, as I start to move into areas where, you know, a lot of people will probably see this piece and say, that wasn't puppetry at all. But I'm a puppeteer, and that's the intention I put behind it. People might call it visual theater or kinetic theater or other terms. But for me, it's the basic thing of something that is lifeless coming to life. That makes it puppetry.
That's wonderful. We've had the pleasure of having Basil here for 5 weeks this past summer, building this work here in Chapel Hill. And so I've had the great privilege of watching this creative process. And it's astounding to me, Basil, how you actually do what you just said. How what you see is just a piece of cloth on the floor becomes very spiritual in many ways, because you don't know what's going to happen, and yet it makes all of these moves, much like I think humans are like, where you completely, in some respects, you can't ever anticipate the next move, and I think it's quite beautiful. Shall we look at the video now? Is
sure.
that all right?
Yeah.
Great.
So So it's just great to have the opportunity, Emil, to, you know, to explore and something that's on this scale. I work in New York, and I could never have the space to do this. And, you know, these were just kind of tests to kind of define our vocabulary and in relationship to the music. And there's a lot more to do. But I'm looking forward to it.
Funny tidbit. Of course, there are all these stories that, of course, you can imagine as these artists create these works, things that you don't, as an audience, ever hear about that are part of the process. That are both, I'm sure, exhilarating and frustrating beyond belief. But there was a moment during the rehearsal when he was trying to achieve this incredible effect with smoke, and it kept falling into the orchestra pit. And as you know, we just mentioned the orchestra of St. Luke's will be in that orchestra pit. And they probably won't look too kindly on being covered in smoke while they're trying to play Stravinsky. But these are some of the artistic issues we have to sort of work out as we go forward.
Yes, we
also,
do.
Avoiding smoke alarms, fire alarms would be a good thing too. These are all things that happened in the last 5 weeks, so yeah. It's been an incredible journey, Basil. And I think more than anything else, it's for me, watching you progress has been for me incredibly satisfying to see how you can put an image in your head onto a stage. And I think it's because of the newness of my knowledge to your craft. I think, and probably for a lot of our audiences, it's going to be an incredibly eye-opening and moving experience. Thanks, Basil.
Thank you.
We can move now to Vijay and Prashant. So I'll start with Vijay with you. We've had the privilege of having you here a few times, and we started in 2005 with the premiere of Still Life, The Commentator.
06, I believe.
06, sorry, 06. But who's counting? Although I think you were a math major, weren't you?
Yes. That was long ago.
Long ago. And for us, it was just as we were starting, and when we brought Vijay here with a whole bunch of other collaborators, this piece, I think for many of our audiences, is still talked about today. Mm-hmm. And I think it speaks to not just your musical vision, but your, I think, much larger aesthetic vision as a whole. And so when we asked you to consider this project and also to collaborate with the International Contemporary Ensemble, can you talk a little bit about how it led to your talking to Prashant and bringing this whole project to bear?
Yeah, I'm trying to remember the exact sequence of events, but I think what happened is that I'd been talking to ICE, as they're known, International Contemporary Ensemble, for some time, and we were finally, you know, and we'd talked with you about doing something together, and then when the idea came of incorporating it under this rubric of Stravinsky, I thought, Stravinsky, okay, I mean, I like the guy, I'm influenced by him as a composer, but it's not my number one priority in life or anything to celebrate Stravinsky. then we were looking at dates and for this event, and we said, well, okay, how about March 26th? I said, wait, March 26th of 2013? I'm pretty sure that that's holy, which is the Indian Rite of Spring. It's the holiday, as you know here, because you celebrate it here on campus, as I'm
our students do, yeah.
It's the holiday that kind of marks the arrival of spring, and it's a big, chaotic, sensual party where people throw colored powder and colored liquids on each other, and a lot of teasing and taunting. It's very actually sexualized, and it comes from the story of Radha and Krishna, the Hindu god Krishna, who is depicted often with blue skin, and that's actually because story has it he was very dark-skinned. So this is sort of some way of representing his darkness is by painting in blue. And then his childhood sweetheart or consort in his adolescence, this woman, young woman named Radha, and all of her friends, the gopis is her name. And the story, it turns out, was that she was supposedly very fair-skinned, and one day, as one of their little flirtatious interactions, he threw color at her to kind of even the score or something like this. And so that, you know, is actually one of the originating myths that gives rise to this celebration that actually takes place all over the world now, is in the Indian diaspora and even among UNC frat boys, it seems. So then I thought, well, okay, Stravinsky, great, but Rite of Spring, I mean, this is the quintessential Rite of Spring. And it's about transformation, it's about that movement from winter to spring, it's about rebirth, it's about fertility, and it's about 6, and it's about God. So it's sort of about everything. And then I thought, well, okay, ballet, right? This was a ballet. Let's think about what it's going to look like. And then I thought, well, my dude, this good friend of mine for many years, is one of the great filmmakers of today. His name is Prashant Bhargava. And he, last year, premiered a film called Patang, which was shot in Ahmedabad during the Kite Festival, which maybe you know about, where there's a sort of competitive kite flying where they lace the kite string with broken glass and basically dust ground up glass so that can be used to cut other people's kite strings. But it's also a very colorful and very festive affair, and it features prominently in his film, which is a brilliant film, which is actually touring theatrically now. And what I really admired about it, among many things, was, for one thing, it really captures the images and the color, the many colors and all the movement in the sky, but also it really captures the people, it really tells their stories in such a beautiful and direct and rich way. And I guess when I think about Rite of Spring, I think about, you know, this word primitivism has been kicked around today. And, you know, basically you have these elite bourgeois artists in Paris, you know, from Russia, making this fantasy about warring tribes. And to me, like, the warring tribes are, at the time, as was said, you know, Europe is a big bunch of warring tribes. I mean, you know, there was World War I. There's also sort of the Russian cultural invasion into Paris culture, which is this is very much an expression of. And there's them kind of representing their own kind of mythic past in a certain kind of deliberately primitivist way, which to me is, it's a fantasy, you know. And I thought that what would be great to do is actually, let's look at something real. Let's not talk about a fantasy about spring, but let's look at what really happens. So, you know, very hastily back in February, we figured out that, oh my God, Holi is in like 2.5 weeks. and, you know, I talked to Prashant about it, and he had the idea of going to the mythic birthplace of Krishna, which is in Uttar Pradesh, a northern state in India, the Braj region. And over there, Holi lasts not one day, but 8. It's 8 days and nights of amazing festivals, rituals, partying, kind of sexual teasing and taunting, very austere rituals, singing, and it's this very transformative moment for that entire community. And he captured some incredible footage, which we can show you some of right sure. now, I guess.
We'll do that and maybe ask Prashant to comment on it. But before we do that, could you speak just to the musical compositional aspect of how you're approaching this piece?
Yeah, so I'm creating a piece for ICE. It's going to be a sort of large-ish chamber ensemble. It's 10 pieces, 2 pianos, 2 percussionists, 3 strings, and 3 winds. You know, and I'm not so concerned with trying to make a Stravinsky-derived piece or anything, but I am, you know, the more we've been staring at this whole the problem that you pose to us, the harder it is to escape that influence. So, you know, I mean, there's a bassoon in the piece. All right, I'll tell you. right. But there'll also be electronics, and I'm also, as you'll see in the excerpt we're going to show you, which is just, it's kind of an amalgam of possible tastes musically of what might happen in 6 months when we do this. But there are also some electronic, there's some sampling of the audio from the record from the film that they gathered there over those 8 days, and so you actually hear what's actually happening. And I'm interested in finding ways to incorporate that into the work. So.
Oh, so then actually, what they'll hear in terms of the crowd, that audio will be sampled into your piece. Interesting.
Maybe.
Wow. Yeah. Maybe. Sorry. Heard it here first. So Prashant, we'll show the film maybe, and then you can speak to that whole process for you.
Okay.
Okay, great.
Thank you.
So I actually saw this for the first time yesterday, I think, or the day before. And I had no idea what to expect, I have to say. And when I saw this, my jaw dropped. I thought, it's exactly what we were hoping for. So
that doesn't always happen.
Prashant, can you tell us a little bit about this?
So I'm a narrative-based filmmaker, and I tread the line between narrative and documentary in my process. So during my first film, Patang, I spent 3 years doing research, living in the community, getting to know people. And it was really through that process of intimacy that we were able to make the film. So when Vijay called me and said, let's do Holi, I was like, there's only one place to do it, which is in that Brudge region. But I've never really been there. And how am I going to pull this off? Like, it's somewhat absurd to go to a place and try to capture that living heritage without affecting the environment of with your cameras in a very true sense. And I thought of Holi as the way that I had celebrated throughout my life and seen it, which is a very kind of throw color laugh. Someone gets pissed off because you've got them drenched in something, and that's about it, you know? So it's like, how are we going to make this whole piece about Stravinsky, you know, this journey of this cathartic kind of sacrifice or whatever it was? We did make a conscious choice that we didn't want to go on the dark side of the ritual, and we wanted to show something a little bit more positive in terms of that transformation. So I was kind of blind going there. I did my research in terms of what I could find out on the internet and watch whatever videos I knew about, assembled a number of my crew from my prior film, and brought an American cinematographer, Craig Marsden, down with me. And both me and him shot. And every day was an absurd adventure. I mean, we would be having these cameras and covered in this rain gear and have a hat on, and I would come back and head to toe be drenched in literally shit and color and liquid stuff, and every day would be some new physical ailment of some ear infection, for 4 months afterwards my toes were painted, and I finally understood what it was to kind of you know, when a man kind of dresses as a woman, what do you feel? And I'm looking down and all my toes are painted red because they're soaked. It's, you know, so all these things started to happen. But I was pretty freaked out when I got there. I mean, I'm Hindu and I believe in a lot of the things. But when I reached this place, there was a fanaticism about the way that people became these entities of Radha and Krishna to a point which was just freaky to me. I mean, it was like they were embodying this. And I would talk to the priest, and they would say, this is the time of our, you know, springtime transformation of season, and it's our time when we have peak sexual energy and we need an outlet. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, you're justifying these 10-year-olds saying the most crude sexual things, looking at women and spraying them in the ass and in the tits, and that's what you're saying to me? And that's exactly what they were saying, and they were participating in it as well with complete kind of joy. And, you know, I started out, and they would have these wild things that were just much more beyond just simply throwing color. In one section, the men from Krishna's playground get high on bhang and are completely hallucinating and make this triumphant procession through the streets to the other village. Go to the temple, sit down, and buckets of nasty stuff is being thrown. I'm sitting with them, all drenched in this stuff, singing these kind of taunting songs. And then they head down to that village where all of Radha's playmates were and all of that, in that mythical town where she's from. And women would be waiting with 6 foot, 7 foot sticks, waiting for these guys. And these guys would hold these very tiny kind of leather shields, and these women would beat them. Beat with them with such animosity that you knew that there was domestic violence in this area, that this was not just something that was very plain. It was the one day where they could release all that animosity. And I was just so blown away that this whole experience of shooting, and then you saw a little bit of the guys on the corner, and they would be standing there like gangs, you know, with their water guns and with these buckets. And it felt like the Middle East, you know, if they had guns, it would be a completely different experience. And if you came in with your car and your door was unlocked, that door was going to be open and 3-4 buckets were going to come into that car. So, you know, and when I came back, I was just really pleasantly struck to see that we had actually captured something that went so profoundly along with the journey of the Rite of Spring. Mm-hmm. Something ritualistic, something very primal, sexual, violent, warring of tribes. All of these different elements are there. And I've spent now about 3 months going through the material and editing it. And the way that I've approached it is very much laying down the Rite of Spring as a track. I've looked at each section and the original title that's there, tried to describe those in a couple of adjectives, and then I try to express what's happening with the actual momentum of the city as a sexual objective, all in reverence to the goddess Radha. So it's like, I'm waiting for you, or punish me, I'm yours, or I'm burning up, I'm hard. You know, like, these are the type of things that I'm kind of looking at, and then when I look at the people, I can really find those moments that correlate along with that journey. It's been a kind of complicated emotional journey to tap into that, into what it means to be devoted to a goddess, to pay a true respect to the people there, to understand this complicated work of something. You know, I had a little bit of classical training, piano training, but when I came to this, I've really grown to really enjoy the Rite of Spring and appreciate it for what it is, and all of those kind of, every movement is just so, you know, there's no rhyme or reason except your gut that can take mm-hmm. you there, and you have to tap into that mm-hmm. to make it happen. So I'm really excited to continue it, and you know, one aspect that I'm trying to think of now is, how do you represent that goddess Radha in terms of some personification of that, whether it's illustrative, whether it's a new kind of component we can shoot in a fantasy way, you know, to show what they are admiring. Because right now you have not a lot of interplay between men and women other than women beating men or men taunting them. So that's something that has to be explored. But mm-hmm. otherwise, you know, really excited about this process.
Mm-hmm. Wow, great. You know, it's really, really unfortunate that we have so many inarticulate artists on our stage. all of you, and of course, all the artists who preceded you. Well, our time has come to a close here. I feel like Mr. Rogers.
maybe the shoe thing.
I want to thank all of you for joining us, and I'd like to ask you, of course, to thank these three artists who are left, but also for everyone that was with us today. Thank you all for coming. I hope you get a taste, a little bit of a glimpse into the work that's been going on regarding this project that goes far beyond looking backwards, but it's really all about where we are today and what we're doing going forward. We have another concert tonight. I hope you'll join us with the Silk Road Ensemble. It's going to be a wonderful year. Thank you very much for your support.